I am Dr. Rashid Ahmed from the Department of Physics of Kohat University of Science and Technology in the subject of Classical Mechanics with a course code PHY211. We are at the lecture number 15 and the topic is Derivation of Lagrange's Equation from Hamilton's Principle. In the previous lecture, we have derived the Lagrange equations from Hamilton's Principle for a single variable. In today's lecture, we will see how to generalize this procedure and to derive the Lagrange equations for different variables and also their derivatives. So, in order to do this generalization, we will start with the variation of a line integral as we have done before. But now, in this case, you can see over here this j whose variation this j which is a line integral whose variation we want to calculate is a function of a variable y1 and y2. So previously we had this f function of only one variable, but now there is a generalization and we are going from one variable to many variables, and also we are including here the derivatives of these functions. For example, you can see this y1 dot, where this dot represents the derivative with respect to x. Here x is any parameter which is also this f is also a explicit function of this x. Later we will see that we can identify with this parameter x with time as well. But at the moment, you can see that we have made this generalization of this integral and we want to calculate the variation of this line integral j. So generalization is made in two ways. One is increasing the number of variables on which this function depends, and also the derivatives of these variables are included, as well as the parametric dependence of f on x is also included. This is also possible to generalize it further and also include the second and third derivatives, but at the moment we will restrict ourselves only to first derivatives and the generalization to the second derivatives is can be done in similar way. Okay, so now we have written down the most general integral whose variation we want to calculate. The next step is to introduce the expansion parameter alpha. So here we have to expand our function, and for this expansion we need a parameter which is a small parameter. Let's call it an alpha. We have already done this procedure in the case of a single variable, but since we are making a generalization, the steps of derivation are just similar. But here the only complication is coming from considering the many variables and their derivatives. Okay, so let's introduce an expansion parameter alpha into the game here. And now you can see that any variable, for example, let's take the first variable y1, it depends on the parameter x and also on the alpha. The alpha is an expansion parameter. X is not an expansion parameter, but it's some physical parameter. But we have also included alpha to help us in expanding and calculating order by order the variation. So here you can see the first term is x0, where the value of alpha is 0, plus alpha eta 1 x, where eta are some functions which we vary in a way that their variation at the endpoints vanishes. And similarly, we can take another variable y2, and it also depends upon the x and alpha. And similarly, we can expand it into the leading order term, where alpha, the value of alpha is 0, plus the first order term and second order term and so on. Again, here we have restricted ourselves to the expansion of alpha up to the first order, and second order and third order are neglected because of the smallness of the parameter alpha. So now the correct path which we are seeking, which the particle whose dynamics are considered will follow, is in the leading terms. So these leading terms y1, y2 and etc. will give us the correct path when we make the variation. So this will give us the correct path. And these functions over here, as I have already mentioned, this eta 1, eta 2 and so on, all these functions are constructed in a way that they vanish at x is equal to x1 and x2. So at the extreme points or at the maximum points, these variations of these functions vanish, and allowing us to calculate the correct path. Okay, after defining this integral j in terms of many variables and their derivatives, and also introducing an expansion parameter alpha, and making all the variables depend upon this alpha, and making an expansion, and then introducing function eta 1 and eta 2, we are ready now to make our calculations, to proceed with our calculations of j, variate and calculate the correct path. So first thing we do in variation, this delta, to write it explicitly in terms of the partial derivatives, and these partial derivatives are taken with respect to alpha. You here you can see that this j, this is the definition of actually variation, and here we take the partial derivative of j with respect to alpha in the differential d alpha, and in the right side of calculation we have shown only derivative with respect to y1, and this can easily be extended to the other variables. Here we have used the chain rule. So you can see over here the chain rule, that is, since f is a function of y1, so we have taken derivative of y1, and then y depends upon alpha in terms, then we have taken the derivative of y with respect to alpha. So in this way, indirectly with the help of chain rule, we have taken the derivative of f with respect to alpha. And similarly, since the derivative of y also depends on the f also depends upon the derivative of y, that is y dot, so therefore we have also used chain rule over here, and this index I actually represents all the other variables for which we have made generalization. So you can see the summation over here going on the index I. The integral is going on the parameter dx, but the summation is going on the index I, so that all the variables are included here. Now this second term, let's we have, since we have to do this integration, so let's talk about the second term first, and we want to integrate it by parts. So for the second term, to make an integration by parts, as we know that in integration by parts we have two functions, the first function and the second function, and this is the formula, and if we apply it and do this integration by parts, then this first term, which we call the leading term, will actually vanish. And now you remember, you know that why it vanishes. It vanishes because the at the end points, the variation at the end point, at the 1 and 2 vanishes, are identical, therefore they cancel each other, and therefore the surface terms or the end point terms are equal to 0. So therefore this first term goes away. So this means that if first term goes away, then here in this integral, this term can be replaced by only the second term. So what we do now is to and this is the reason that all varied paths pass through the x1, y1 and x2, y2. So therefore these are the end points, this one and this one the end points, and since all paths pass through these end points, therefore they are equal at these end points and we can cancel them. In other words, we say that the variation at the end points are equal to 0. Okay, so now what we can do, that we can replace this second term inside this integral after doing this integration by parts by this term. So the condition for stationary points, as we know that we have calculated the delta j, and from the conditions of condition on this stationary points, we can derive the this using this condition, that is the displacements y, or the variation in y, are equal to the derivative of y at with respect to alpha at alpha is equal to 0 d alpha. So this is the condition, this is the condition for these calculating these stationary points. And if we put this condition into this in this variation, then what we get that either this is equal to 0 or this whole term is equal to 0. And from this we get the generalized Euler-Lagrange equations, as you can see over here. Here we get the generalized Euler-Lagrange equations, that is del f by del y, and you can see now this generalization in terms of the variable index I. So now we don't have only one variable, but we have multiple variables and their derivatives, where I goes from 1 to n, and these are the Euler-Lagrange equations. So previously we had only one equation over here, did for the only one variable, but now with the straightforward generalization you can see that we have now many variables and their derivatives, and there are actually n equations over here just for one variable. So in this way we have generalized our procedure of deriving the Lagrange equation from variational principle. Okay, now it's also important to make a connection with the Hamilton's principle. This is the this was the first part of the lecture where we have shown that how we can generalize the variational principle for more than one variables. Before that we have done it for just single variable, and now we have generalized it for more than one variables. But now we would like to make connection with the Hamilton's principle. This is done straightforwardly. For example, if our line integral is now I is now equal to the integral of Lagrangian, where Lagrangian is a function, as you know, equal to L is equal to kinetic energy minus potential energy, which we have constructed in previous lectures. And here the variables are q, q dots, t. These are the variables on L on which this L defined. So now instead of this J integral, which we have done on the previous slides, we label it with the I, and this function f is now explicitly equal to the function L, and these are the explicit variables on which it depends. And this is the q dot, which means that it is the velocity terms, these are the position terms, position dependence, velocity dependence, and the time. Now here you can see that x is now corresponding to the t parameter, time parameter, q dots are the velocities, and q's are the positions on which this Lagrangian L depends. So we make some transformations from general variational principle to the Lagrangian. Here we identify x with the t, as I have already mentioned, and y, these were the displacements. If you remember, we make this correspondence with the generalized coordinates q. So now you can see that this function f in the variational principle, which was the function of y and y dot and x, now corresponds to the function L, which is Lagrangian. Q, these are the generalized coordinates. So generalized coordinates, we mean these could be positions, these could be velocities, or any other things. In this lecture, I will give you some specific examples where I will give you that what are Q's actually mean, or what Q's can mean in particular situation. These can be position, these can be angles, anything. These are the generalized coordinates, and Q dots are the corresponding velocities of these generalized coordinates, and T, as you know, it's the parameter which parametrize our whole Lagrangian. So under these transformations, now we are ready to calculate the Lagrange equations and do all these steps of variational principle. And at the end, when we do all the steps, for example, we do the variations and do the partial integrations and put the terms at the boundary equal to zero, and at the end what we get the Euler-Lagrange equations, or simply the Lagrange equations. And this is not the only one equation, but these are set of many equations. For example, these could be n equations depending on the situation. And here you can see this d by dt del L by del Q dot minus del L by del Q, and this index I goes from 1 to n. These are the Lagrange equations. So in the first part, we have derived our Euler-Lagrange equations from general variational principle, and we have generalized it to the many variables case. And in the second part, now we have made the connection with the Hamilton principle or the Lagrangian specifically, and derived these Lagrange equations. And now we will go on and make give you some examples of them, simple examples where you can know that how in some physical situation you can with the physical principles you can use these mathematical equations to derive the actual equations of motion, from physical principles. Okay. So far we have covered two parts of our this lecture. In the first part, the most general situation of variational principle many variables, and then we made the connection with the Lagrange equations for many variables. And now one more thing, all these things were done for the holonomic constraints. If you remember, the in case of the holonomic constraints, where we have certain types of equations, certain types of connections between the constraints, and if we have the non-holonomic constraints, how we can write this Hamilton principle for the non-holonomic constraints. But generalizing it to the non-holonomic constraints gives us two problems, two immediate restrictions. The first one is that the generalized coordinates are not independent of each other. So this is a problem when we generalize it to the non-holonomic constraints. In holonomic constraints, it is simple, because generalized coordinates are all independent. That's why they are called holonomic. But here, all generalized coordinates are not independent. In other words, we mean that it is not possible to reduce them to the following form. This form. So we cannot write a function in this form, because all the generalized coordinates are not independent of each other. So then it is not possible to write the function equal to zero. So this is the first problem while generalizing to the non-holonomic constraints from a holonomic constraint. The second problem is that the variations, the virtual displacements with respect to which we want to make a variation and want to calculate the correct path, are not consistent with the constraints or with the equations of constraints. So these are the two basic problems which we face while going from holonomic constraints to the non-holonomic constraints. In order to overcome these problems, what we do is the following, that we go towards the semi-holonomic treatment of our problem. In this case, what we do by the semi-holonomic constraints, that we make our displacements independent and do the variations, and then after that we go towards the method, very well-known method called the Lagrange multiplier method. So in principle, it means that we have separate equations for the constraints. So we have the equations for the dynamics of the particle, and then we have equations for the constraints. So we solve them separately, and at the end we integrate these equations of constraint into the dynamics, and by this way we can treat these constraints. Otherwise, so this is kind of semi-holonomic treatment. We cannot generally give a procedure where we can treat all kinds of constraints, but certain types of constraints are certainly treatable with the help of Lagrange multiplier method. That I will explain in a moment. Okay, so variational principle is possible when we can put these functions which depending on alpha from q1 to qn and q1 dot to qn dot equal to 0, and then we have m equations which are possible for value of alpha equal to 1 to m. So this is the most general thing. Excuse me. But now we can put this function equal to 0, and we'll have these equations, we'll have these m equations defined, and some of these equations will be the equations of constraints. All of them are not equations of the dynamics equations, but some of them are equations of constraints. You will see illustration of this into simple examples I present at the end. Okay, so now we have reached to the point of Lagrange undetermined multiplier method. This is very famous method which helps us in treating the constraints into the equations of motion. So it helps us to separate the constraints which are consistent with the equations of motion, and then solve them separately, and at the end add them up with the equations of motion. So first of all, we eliminate the virtual displacements. So after eliminating the virtual displacements, we have these equations. So these are the functions, if you remember, and these lambdas are called actually the undetermined quantities, or these are the multipliers. So these are called the Lagrange multipliers. So these lambdas are now Lagrange multipliers. These are multipliers because these are multiplied with these functions, and these are m multipliers depending on how many constraints we have. And now the whole purpose is to determine their values. Once we know the values of lambdas, we know these equations, we can solve them, and constraints equations are solved. So these alpha range from 1 to n, depends upon the situation, that how many constraints we have and how many equations of motions we have. But the message is that if you can put by eliminating virtual displacements the equations of constraints in this form, where lambdas are the undetermined multipliers, then we will determine their values and constraints are solved. So we can make its connection to the Hamilton principle. So let's now define the Hamilton principle in terms of Lagrange multipliers. So you remember that we have this Lagrangian, the integral of the Lagrangian L dt equal to 0, and this variation must be equal to 0 for the correct path. So this implies that we have these equations of motion, which we have already done. I am just reminding you so that now we can add the equations of constraints over here in this procedure, and you remember that how it changes the basic principle when there are equations of constraints. So Hamilton principle then becomes, as you can see now, with L we have added these equations of constraint. These Lagrange multipliers are now added to the L. At the moment we don't know what lambdas are. Actually this is the purpose, to determine the lambda. And variation is now performed with respect to n delta q's which are the variations, and m lambda alphas. So we will not only vary L, but we will also vary this whole thing with respect to lambda as well. So we will vary it with respect to Q's, the generalized coordinates, but we will also vary it with respect to lambdas. And what we will get, not only the n equations, but we will get m plus n equations. So these n are the equations of the dynamics, and m are the equations of the constraints. And at the end, we will solve them together, and in this way, along with the dynamics equations, we will have the constraint equation solved. So the resulting equations will be of this type, where you can see now we have these generalized forces over here. So these generalized forces would mean that the forces coming from the constraints as well, because we know that these forces, these constraints generate sometimes some types of forces inside the system, and now these forces are included here. So this is the most general form of for the QK, and you can see that lambdas are here, and these lambdas are actually the forces of generate or parameterize the forces of constraints. So now it's time to give you examples. So you can in order to recall what we have done so far, in the first part of the lecture we had derived or generalized the variational principle to many variables, and in the second part we have derived the Euler-Lagrange equations, And in the third part, we have included the constraints, the non-holonomic constraints into the business, and we have generalized the Hamilton principle, which now includes the equations of constraints. And now we know that if we make a variation of this integral, line integral with of this Lagrangian, we will make it not only with respect to the generalized coordinates, but we will also make it with respect to the Lagrange multipliers. Now let me give you two examples. One is not that straightforward, but the other one is very straightforward, and you will be able to understand how this all procedure works. So in this first example, consider the particle with the following Lagrangian, this one. So you can see it's very simple Lagrangian of a particle, a simple particle whose mass is m, for example electron, and it is moving, and this is the velocities x dot square, y dot square, z square square, and minus v is the potential. So this is the kinetic energy and this is the potential energy term. And these are subject to the constraints. For example, there are some sorts of constraints over here. Let's say x dot y dot y, this is x dot y dot plus ky is equal to 0 is the equation of constraints. Now if this is so, then what we have to do in order to calculate the equations of motion, what we have to do is to calculate the variation, and all after all these variation we have to put the variation equal to 0, and what we get at the end, these equations for all the components, for example the first component and the second component, for the third component, and the equations of constraints separately. So as you have seen that we have used the variational principle, and there we have made the variations not only with respect to the generalized coordinates, which are x, y, and z in this case, and also with respect to lambda, and we got these three equations of motions and one equations of constraint. But as I have said earlier, that there is more explicit and simple illustration of all this procedure, and for this I have included the hoop rolling. And consider that we have a hoop who has two generalized coordinates, for example x and theta. These are the two generalized coordinates, and I will show you in the diagram that why there are only two generalized coordinates and where we can find them. And then the equation of rolling constraint is, this is the equation of constraint, because r d theta is equal to dx, and in this case you can see a theta, that is a coefficient of d theta, is r here, this one you can see, and the coefficient of dx is minus 1, that is ax, because if you take it to the other side of the equation, this ax is minus 1. So to see how it is possible, let's go towards schematic diagram. So imagine that we have this hoop which is rolling down this surface, and here the angle theta, so this is one of our generalized coordinates, as you can see, when this hoop rolls down, this theta changes this from this point of contact, and the distance from this point of contact is called x. So these are the two generalized coordinates we are using for this hoop rolling down. Since it will have a friction, so it has some kind of constraint over here, that it is in the there are the frictional forces, so we have to treat them separately. And there is another angle involved, phi, over here, but this angle is not important because we are not changing it. If you change it as well, because we are not changing the slope, it is fixed, this support is fixed on which this plane is fixed on which this hoop is rolling, so therefore our generalized coordinates are only two, that is theta and x. And now our Lagrangian, as you know, is our function L is equal to T minus V. So let's calculate the kinetic energy and potential energy terms. So for the kinetic energy term, we have as you know, because we will go to the center of mass coordinates, so here kinetic energy is half mx dot square plus half m r theta dot square. This first term is the center of mass motion, and this is the motion about the center of mass. So you can see this is the motion of the center of mass, and this is the motion about the center of mass. So we have included both terms in kinetic energy. And then we go towards the potential energy. The potential energy is equal to mgl minus x sine theta, and you can easily recognize this from this here, from this diagram, that our kinetic energy and potential energy terms, these both. So once we have kinetic energy and potential energy, then you know that our Lagrangian is equal to T minus V. So we have to simply put in the values. This is the kinetic energy for T minus the potential energy. And once we have the kinetic energy minus the potential energy, we have to calculate the use the variational principle in order to calculate the Lagrange equations. So if you do the variations over here with respect to x and theta, because these are the your generalized coordinates, with respect to this, you calculate the variations, you will get this equation of motion and another equation of motion, to have two equations of motion because you have two variables, excuse me, and then the equation of constraint. So this is our equation of constraint, and you can clearly identify it with the diagram that r theta dot are actually x dot. So there are three unknowns now, x, theta and lambda, because lambda is the Lagrange multiplier which is entering over here, and lambda is our along with the generalized coordinates, we have this lambda for the constraints, and this x theta are the coordinates. So now you can connect all this from this example, this procedure, to the general treatment I presented in the beginning. So you can see these are the generalized coordinates, and these are the Lagrange multiplier, which is useful for determining the equations of constraints. And if we differentiate the equations of constraint, we will get r double theta dot x double dot, and the Lagrange equations gives after the second integration, because we want to calculate the forces. So this will give us the x double dot and theta double dot. So force of friction is, so this you will be wondering that what, so these are the forces, the equations of dynamics. So now we know that what x double dot and theta double dot, or so to say the acceleration term and these two generalized coordinates mean, but what is the Lagrange multiplier mean? So this actually is the force of friction coming from the constraint. So in this lecture, in today's lecture, we have seen that how we can generalize our variational principle, and also generalize it from one variable to many variables, and then connect it with the Hamilton principle, and then it generalize it from holonomic constraints to the non-holonomic constraint, and we have then had the Lagrange multiplier method, where we use some multipliers to calculate the equations of the constraints. With this, I think.